All right, I want you to imagine two people with me, and we're just looking on their exterior. We're assuming that they're genuine, but we're just looking on the outside, all right? And I'm going to ask you, which one of these two people would you consider to be spiritual? One person on the outside is what you might call militant, regimented, up late, toiling, up early, back at it, and hard-nosed, and very disciplined over themselves and how they use their time and how they, you know, what they eat, etc. That's one person, the militant person. And they are somber, they are sober, and they're dead serious. The other person sleeps like a baby. And they are filled with such cheerfulness. They spring out of bed in the morning and go through their day with great gladness. And at the end of the day, when they're exhausted and tired, they sleep with the peace of a child, not a newborn. All right. Which one of these people is spiritual? What do you think? So I would say both. Both are spiritual. Which one's more spiritual? Second person. Now, why would I say the second person is probably more spiritual than the first? Well, if by spiritual we mean taught by the Spirit, indwelt by the Spirit, filled with the Spirit, then as we'll see today, the mark upon the spiritual person is primarily a great joy in knowing what God has freely given to them. And their obedience and their hard work flows out of that great conception. In the end, we'll say the spiritual person is both. They are both somber, they are serious, they are sober, they are militant when it comes to sin, but driving it all, in it all, through it all, is a great joy. I hope to persuade you of this by the end, that we might become the truly spiritual. From our verse, which is verse 12 here, we'll have three observations. First, we'll look at the Spirit here that's delineated. Second, His ministry. That'll be largely what the sermon is given to. And then thirdly, we'll take a step back and look at this and our place in God's creation, our purpose of existence as believers. May God bless it to us. First, the Spirit. Paul says here that we have not received the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God. So first, it's a negative. The Spirit that we've received as believers is not the spirit of the world. So of course, the question is, what is the spirit of the world? Well, in the context, the Corinthians were struggling with this very thing. The spirit of the world would be worldliness, or as Paul puts it, fleshliness or carnality. They had an earthly mindset, and they were boasting in appearances and outward things. They had their favorite teachers in the church, and they would cling to that teacher and boast in their name over and against others. The extra spiritual among them would say, well, I'm of Jesus Christ. And they'd say, I don't read John Calvin, I read the Gospels. That's what the super spiritual among them would say, right? And there were factions, there was earthly mindedness. Amen? So that's what they're talking, that is the spirit of the world, worldliness. Or as the Apostle John puts it, the lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. These things do not come from the Father, but they come from the world. Our fleshly lustful impulses, the desire of the eyes in idolatry for things, and then the pride of life, which would be boasting in status, or as they were boasting in their favorite teacher, right? All of those things. That's the spirit of the world. Of course, it is demonic. It's driven by Satan, and it is saturated with sin, the spirit of the world. And Paul says to these believers here who are struggling with this, you know, we haven't received that spirit. But instead, we have received the spirit who is from God. And you'll notice it says who, not which. Or that, because the text is making it very clear to us that this spirit that we have received is not an it, but it is a he, a person. The spirit who comes from God is the Holy Spirit. So Paul is reminding these Corinthians that as believers, They have not received the spirit of the world and worldly mindedness, but they have received a spiritual mind that comes from being indwelt with the person of the Holy Spirit. The third person of the Trinity has been given to us in a unique way. Down payment, indwelt, sealed by the Spirit. He's in us. And we belong to Him. In giving us His Spirit, God has given us Himself. He's put Himself within us. So that's the first point. That's what we're talking about, the Holy Spirit. Amen? We have received the Holy Spirit. Now, second point, this we're going to spend most of our time, is what is His ministry? Which Paul gives very clearly here. What is the ministry of the Holy Spirit in your life as a believer? That's the question we're going to answer with God's help this morning. Well, broadly speaking, the Holy Spirit has a vast ministry. It starts right away in Genesis. As the Spirit of God hovered over the waters, He has a creative ministry. Of course, all of God's works are triune in nature, and the creation was triune in nature, and the Holy Spirit played His part in the creation. Creative Spirit, that God sent forth His Word and His Spirit to create the world. Now, when it comes to sinful humanity, the ministry of the Holy Spirit is as such. Jesus tells us what it is. He will convict the world, right? Worldliness, the world. He will convict the world of concerning sin, righteousness, judgment. So the ministry of the Holy Spirit to this fallen world is that threefold ministry of convicting the lost of sin, righteousness, and judgment, as Jesus says. As it says in the Old Testament, His Spirit contends with men. The ministry of the Holy Spirit towards unbelievers is a ministry of great conviction. That's why false teachers who never preach about sin do not have the power of the Holy Spirit upon their ministries, because the Holy Spirit is striving with the sinner about their guilt and their sin, that He might bring them to Christ for forgiveness. The other part of the Holy Spirit's ministry is, as Jesus says, just a few verses after that, this is John 16, He says, when He comes, He will, what does He say? He will what? Glorify Me. He will take of the things that belong to Me and make them known to you. The ministry of the Holy Spirit, primarily concerning unbelievers, is conviction of sin, righteousness, judgment. The ministry of the Holy Spirit concerning believers, as Jesus puts it, is what? To take of the things of Christ, make them known, and glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, the whole package of the Holy Spirit's ministry toward human beings can be summarized in that dual phrase, law, gospel. Law, gospel is the ministry of the Holy Spirit to humanity. Now, Paul here is talking specifically about believers in verse 12. Now, he says, he could say you, but he says we. Now, we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who's from God, that we might understand the things freely given to us by God. As a side note, this is just absolutely glorious. Have you ever puzzled about why is it that when God's revelation sang at its highest pitch, what form did it come in? Did it come in primarily poetry? It often came in poetry, but not when it sings at its highest pitch. Did it come at the thunderings of a prophet? Nope. It came through a letter, the epistles. When God's revelation to us, the full revelation of who He is in Jesus Christ, was coming to us in its final form, it came in personal correspondence letters. That's striking. It speaks of the intimacy that we share as children of God and the intimacy that we share with each other, and that's what Paul's talking about. He's included in this. We are but what? Brothers. Call no man on earth your father, you have one father. Call no man rabbi, you have one teacher, one leader, who is Christ. And you are all brothers. Certainly Paul does have authority as an apostle, right? I just think it's marvelous that we are sharing in this with him, that we are co-heirs together with the apostle Paul, with the greatest of all the saints. We are of equal standing. That's amazing. Well, anyways, back to our text. The specific ministry of the Holy Spirit to us is, well, he certainly reveals our sin. Don't let anyone tell you that the Holy Spirit's ministry towards a believer doesn't include conviction of sin. Just read the New Testament. There's sin everywhere. The Holy Spirit wrote that, you know. He does convict us of our sin, but he does so always in conjunction with the gospel. The gospel. And that's what Paul says here. Why, ultimately, what is the main oomph of the ministry of the Holy Spirit to us? Well, he's been given what? That we might understand the things freely given to us by God. I haven't even interpreted it yet. It just says that. We have the Holy Spirit. Why? Why do you have the Holy Spirit if you're a believer? Primarily, so that you can come into more and more of an understanding of the things God has lavished upon you. That's the ministry of the Spirit. And that's what creates the joyful, spiritual person who has a deep experiential sense of what they have in Christ. Well, let's break this down. First, the ministry of the Holy Spirit is just basically that we might understand. It's a teaching ministry. Amen? An understanding ministry that we might know, that we might grow in our knowledge of God and what he's given us. That is intellectual. Right? We're talking about facts. We're talking about promises. We're talking about things that have happened, things that are happening, things that will happen, things God has promised that he will do and has done. Knowledge. The spiritual person is somebody with deep, deep understanding. We would call it spiritual intelligence. Marks the spirit-filled person. Amen? Understanding. Now, what kind of knowledge or understanding is this? It's not bare cognitive grasp on things. It's not just having the conception of things. Can an unbeliever, an unspiritual person, as Paul says later, can an unspiritual, unregenerate person, can they understand the concepts of the gospel? Yes. Can an unbeliever understand the concept of God forgiving somebody of their cosmic guilt? They can understand that concept, right? They just reject the concept, but they can understand it. Can they understand God adopting people into his own family and giving them the whole universe? Of course they can understand that. So when Paul says we've been given the Holy Spirit to understand the things freely given us by God, it's not merely conceptual. You with me? It's not merely factual. But it's an experiential understanding that sinks into our hearts, that's written on our hearts, where we not only know these things, but we believe them, we embrace them, we treasure them, we feel their effects on our heart and on our life, we walk in them. Amen? That's the kind of understanding we're talking about. Experiential. That takes God's truth and doesn't just see it as a bare fact or just a bare glorious fact, amen, but sees the faith sees itself as the recipient of that. Faith wants in on that, God's glory. Faith wants in on salvation, and so faith takes salvation for itself. That's what happens when somebody's born again right away. They see Christ, but they don't just see him. What do? They take him, all right? Now, my son, he's a man of few words, all right? But he just learned the big one. You know what it is? Mine. And he can hardly say it. It sounds like half a sound. If you know my son, you know he just makes sounds. So he says, like, mine. And so, you know, he'll walk by you, take the iPad right out of your hand, go sit on the couch and say, mine. He understands what that is. Right? He didn't just understand what an iPad is, but he understands that he wants it for himself. The newborn faith of the believer, the entire Christian life is lived that way, seeing the things of God and saying, mine. Almost when you can't say anything else. you can't articulate the gospel. When you're first converted, you couldn't articulate the gospel like you can now. I guarantee it. You couldn't articulate the doctrine of the Trinity or historical faith or even your understanding of the inerrancy and infallibility of Scripture. When you first became a believer, I bet you couldn't articulate all that. But you know what you could do? You could say, mine. So that's the essence of spiritual understanding and knowledge that takes in faith to itself. So the Holy Spirit gives this to us. We've been given the Holy Spirit for this very purpose, to understand experientially the things that God has freely given to us. Now, what are the things God has freely given to us? Well, before we get into them, we'll just say, what's a word we can put on that? The things freely given by God? Grace. Understanding the grace of God. We have been given the Holy Spirit to understand more and more deeply and to feel the effects on our hearts of God's grace. Now, just as we say, a false teacher who never preaches on sin is not being used by the Holy Spirit to convict sinners of sin, because that's what he's trying to do, and that's the very thing the false teacher is not doing, right? On the same note, we would say that a Christian ministry, a ministry to believers in Jesus Christ, that does not focus and center on this, the believer growing and going deeper and deeper into the things that God has freely given them, a ministry that's not there and doesn't focus there, will stunt the growth of the believers under it. I don't know how much clearer Paul can be. Why do we have the Holy Spirit? This is why: to understand more and more the things we freely have been given in Christ. And a ministry that wants the power of the Holy Spirit on it has got to nestle right in there and stay there. Even as you preach sin and you exhort to holiness, we stay here for the believer. Okay, well, what can we say about this ministry of the Spirit to the believer? Well, I will begin by saying that it is counterintuitive. It's counterintuitive. The objection is raised. If the gospel is that, and it's simply about what God has freely given us, what we receive by faith and faith alone, that we add nothing to it, but he simply lavishes grace upon sinners like that, well, if that's the gospel, then it's going to create monsters of iniquity. Isn't that the objection? If that's what it is, and if you stay there, and if you focus there, and if you simply, through it all, put the oomph on what God has given to the believer, what they freely have, you're going to create people that sin freely. People that say, well, I might as well sin more, right? That's the objection. Maybe you should add a little bit of their own works in there, right? Let's just add a little bit of their works into the equation, just to keep people from just going off in sin. That sounds wise, doesn't it? That has the appearance of wisdom, but that has no power against the flesh. The gospel is counterintuitive, and this is part of the very genius of the gospel, that it works like this. Now, if we're not being accused of preaching absolute lawlessness, then we are not preaching the biblical gospel. Paul preached a gospel so free that what did his opponents say? Well, let's just sin more that grace may abound. If that objection doesn't come to the free proclamation of the gospel, you're not preaching it like Paul did. Amen? That objection should come to us, and we can deal with that objection. It's not a true objection. Paul deals with it, Romans 6. But that will incite that objection out of worldly-minded hearers. Why? Because this is counterintuitive. You wouldn't think it would work like this, but it actually does. Now, what I'm going to try to do here, and I'm going to lay myself upon the Holy Spirit here, I'm going to seek to make a demonstration of this truth to you now. And I hope to persuade you of this before this sermon is over. Now, Paul's already in the mindset of doing persuasions here. As we read in the beginning of the chapter, when he came to the Corinthians, he decided to know nothing except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Isn't that amazing? He was foolish enough to believe that he could change these people and keep them walking with God with one message, Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Did Paul preach other things than Christ and Him crucified? He didn't just say those words all the time. Well, certainly he preached many doctrines, but they all found their center in Christ and Him crucified. That's really where he was all the time. Now, when he came to them, he says this in verse 3, and this is very encouraging. I was with you in weakness and fear and much trembling. The Apostle Paul was trembling when he went to preach the gospel to the Corinthians. I find that very encouraging. When you go to your coworker or your neighbor to preach the gospel and you're trembling, you're in good company, because Paul himself trembled as he went to preach the gospel. But this was for a purpose. In verse 4, and my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. What Paul's saying here is that he could have used techniques. He could have used great eloquence or worldly arguments or flair. He could have dimmed the lights and turned on the music to get a decision. But if he knew if their decision to follow Christ was based on Paul's eloquence or was based on manipulative techniques of the day, that he knew their faith wouldn't really be in God then. It would be based on that manipulative technique. And when someone else comes along who's better at that manipulative technique, guess what? He's going to persuade him to go the other way. That's what Paul means when he says that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. So Paul simplified his message. And he emphasized the truth of Jesus Christ and Him crucified, the word of the cross, foolishness to the world, but wisdom to those who are being saved. And he banked upon the Holy Spirit adding His power to that simple message and owning it to their hearts. You guys with me? And that's what he means when he says, my speech and my message were in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. This has been described by some as, paraphrasing Paul here, my preaching was characterized not by manipulative techniques of communication, but by a supernatural verification that was supplied by the power of the Spirit of God. This demonstration here is almost a legal term where something is proven as certain and true. And Paul says, when I preached the simple gospel, unadorned, the Holy Spirit came to your hearts and proved, verified, certified to you in your heart that this was in fact true. It was the spiritual power of God upon the gospel message. What we might call in rougher terms, irresistible grace. That the Holy Spirit convinced the hearers that the message was certain. You with me? So Paul didn't lean on outward techniques. He leaned on the Spirit of God in the simple message of the cross to do that. Well, I'm going to try to do something similar today. May God help me. I'm submitting to you that this works, beloved. That emphasizing the free grace you've received in Christ is the ministry of the Holy Spirit, and in fact doesn't lead to sinfulness, but leads to holiness. I'm going to try to prove that to you now. So let's make a demonstration of it. We're going to answer the question, what are the things that God has freely given to us? And we're going to get very specific about those. Before we do that, I want you to think of a sin in your life that you're really struggling with. Whatever it is. A sin that's haunting you today. A sin that you know this afternoon is going to be crouching at your door. Think of that sin, okay? And we're going to look at the things God has freely given us in Christ. And if you're a believer, what I'm saying to you is the knowledge of these things will make that sin lose its power. This is one of the great tests of faith. How do you know if you're a real believer? Well, if the things we're about to look at make you lose your taste for sin, if they make you say, if God is that great, He's better. If they make you hate your sin more and want to walk with Christ closer, that is a sign of life. But if the things we're going to look at, the things God has freely given believers, if these things make you say, you know what? it's okay. I can sin and I can ask for forgiveness later. If God's grace is so amazing, then he's gonna forgive me. So I might as well go ahead and sin. That is a sign of spiritual death, right? Okay, what has God given the believer? If I could sum it up in one word, what would it be? What do you think? One word to describe what God has given freely to those who are in Christ. Anyone got a guess? Well, salvation is part of it. Grace is part of it. Himself is part of it. Christ is part of it. You know what word I'm going to put on it? Everything. That's a man taught by the Spirit, huh? What has God given to us, beloved? Everything. Now, can I demonstrate it from Scripture? Yes. Go to chapter 3. Now, I want you to remember the context here. These believers are trifling in Corinth. I mean, they're boasting in their favorite teacher. They're quarreling with each other. They are very, very immature and worldly. How's Paul going to combat that? You know, in our wisdom, we'd say, you guys are idiots. Like, you don't deserve any of this. Right? And there's truth to that, and Paul does go there, but not first. This is where he goes first. Verse 21 of chapter 3. So let no one boast in men. Why? Because you don't deserve any of this? That's true, right? But what's the reason Paul gives them? Don't boast in men. Why? Because all things are yours. That's the reason he gives. We're talking about gospel power to break sin. Everything. Now he gives some categories here, beloved. What has God given you in Christ? Well, the first category here, he says, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas, let's call this category knowledge. Now, this applied directly to what they were caught up in. One said, I'm of Apollos, I'm of Cephas, right? Or the spiritual one said, I'm of Christ, you know? But they were feuding. Paul says, don't do that. Why? Because they're all yours. That's profound. They're all yours. All knowledge is yours. All of it. All the teachers of the church are yours. From Moses to John's Apocalypse, they are yours. You might have your favorite books of Scripture and your favorite writers of Scripture. That's all good. As long as you remember that all of it is mine. Now it says the things that have been revealed belong to us and to our children. Ours. It's mine. Not just Paul. Not just David's Psalms. But Ethan's got a psalm in there. That's mine too. You got Asaph's Psalms. Those are mine too. The Kings, the Chronicles, the Prophets. They're mine. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, mine. Isn't that amazing? And what we mean when we say it's mine is not just the actual words themselves, but the realities they point to are mine. It's mine. He says, you don't just have the things that Apollos emphasizes or the things that I emphasize or the things that Peter emphasizes. You got it all. So stop boasting in men. It's all yours. We could apply this also to the great teachers of the church since the close of the canon, beloved. And this is where we tend to gravitate towards our favorite teachers of church history, which is always John Owen, of course. John Owen is wonderful. But I'm not of John Owen. You know why? Because Luther's mine too. And Calvin is mine. And Alauda Equiano, who you might not have heard of, he's mine too. Lemuel Haynes is mine. And that's why you should come hear about him in a couple weeks. Because he's yours. They're all mine. And guess who else is mine? John Wesley's mine. I may not agree with him on everything. I may pity him for his idea that he could lose his own salvation, but he's mine. His grasp upon the love of God in Christ for sinners, that belongs to me and to you. And I'm not going to throw his books out of my library because they're mine. Here's another one, J. Vernon McGee, everyone's favorite dispensationalist, man. Do I disagree with J. Vernon McGee on many things very vehemently? But you know what? He's still mine. So let us not boast in men, beloved, because it all belongs to us. Knowledge, the revelation, the truths of Scripture are ours, all of them. The next category is material. Is there material wealth for the believer? You bet there is. Is that biblical? It's very biblical. Because what does Paul say here? Or the world. The cosmos. Material creation itself. That's what the scripture says, not me. That's what the apostle says. All things are yours, including the universe. How is the universe ours? There's certainly a sense in which it is, because he just said it, right? Is the world ours? Yeah, it's ours. It is presently the servant of our joy, everything in it. Do we have present possession of the world? No. You know, your Jesuit friend might convince themselves that since we own everything, they can steal anything they want. But, you know, that's a subtlety that we will not touch. But is everything ours? Yes. But we don't presently possess it. You know what it's like? It's like in the Batman movie, you know, Dark Knight, first one, Batman Begins, where Bruce Wayne runs away from Gotham City, and he's somewhere deep in Asia. And he gets caught for stealing an apple because he's starving. And when they arrest him, it's right by the shipment area, and there's boxes that have been shipped from the States. And guess what it says on the boxes? Wayne Enterprises. That was his. But he wasn't in present possession of it. You see? Maybe there's some likeness to that. Is the whole creation ours? It is. Though not presently possessed. In glory, in the new heavens and the new earth, we will take full possession of the universe, the material, physical universe. What's that going to be like? Well, it's going to be something. You will enter into an enjoyment and experience of creation unlike anything you've ever experienced. Your interactions with God's creation will be ecstatic. Right now you can see colors, right? And they're very pleasant. In the new creation, you will have more of an intimacy, more of an understanding, and in a way you will taste colors unlike you ever thought possible. You could, in eternity, you will spend 1,000 years looking at a leaf or a tree and seeing God's glory unleashed upon your heart in waves that you can barely handle. Do you believe that? I know that's true. You know how I know that's true? In the Old Testament, once a year, the priests got to go in the Holy of Holies where God's thick presence dwelt. And no, it was incredibly fearful. You know, that priest tasted of God's presence in a powerful, powerful way. The Holy of Holies, where God's presence was concentrated. What is the new creation anyway? It is when the Holy of Holies expands to embrace everything. A simple walk in the woods of the new creation will be as much Holy of Holies as anything else. It will be an experience beyond conception. That's all I can tell you about it, that you will enter into the possession of creation in an amazing way when God will be all in all. You believe that? I bet we really don't believe that's going to happen. That's going to happen. That could be around the corner. That could be today, beloved. Paul says, don't boast in men and don't be worldly, because the whole world is yours and it will be yours. And then he says life and death. Life and death is yours. What does that mean? Well, everything in life is ours. In what sense? In the sense that everything, every circumstance, every experience, every struggle, every joy is what? A servant to make us more like Christ and show us more of God and prepare us more for glory. Everything is our servant. There's, you know, nothing gets lost in your life, because Paul says life is ours. It's mine. It's ours. And it's working for my good. And then he says, death is ours. That's something, right? How can death be ours? Well, it is. Death, the gates of deep darkness that men fear, in Christ, become to us our servant. How? What is death to a believer? It's a portal to glory. That's all it is. What can it do to you? Yeah, maybe it hurts a little bit going through the portal, but then you're through. It's a chariot to take you to God's presence. That's what death is. Do you see death like that? Because it is that for you. You remember in Esther, when the wicked man Haman was plotting against Mordecai, and he worked out the whole thing. I'm gonna hang him in this way, and I'm gonna be honored in his death. And then the king came to Haman and said, What should the king do for the man who he wants to honor? Of course, Haman's thinking about himself, right? So he said, let him be given the best robe and a gold chain, and let him be paraded through the streets. And of course, what happened? Well, in God's providence, Haman, the wicked man, had to do that to his enemy Mordecai. Haman had to honor Mordecai. Amen? He had to lead him through the street in honor. That's what the gospel does to death, beloved. Death, which seeks us, which seeks to have us, put the lights out and pull us down to the deepest depths of hell, has now become Haman to us. And when it gets a hold of us, all it's allowed to do is simply lead us through the streets in triumph and transport us to glory. That's what it does. Death is ours. Time is ours, he says. Time, the present and the future, they're ours. The present, everything in the present is yours, working for your glory. What is it that's bothering you, that you're anxious about? What is it that doesn't feel good right now? Well, guess what? It's yours, and it's being worked for your good. That's what that means. And he says the future is also ours. And I think many of us fall short on this point. He says the future is yours. In other words, nothing to fear. Do you fear the future? You anxious about the future? You shouldn't be, because God says the future is ours. By God's grace, we are the future. But it serves us. The righteous woman, the good, excellent wife in the Proverbs, my favorite line about her is this: she laughs at the time to come. That's the rowdiest woman I ever heard of. She's got children. I mean, she's got her husband. She's got her business. You know what I mean? She's got so much going on. But she laughs at the time to come. That's for all believers. Do you laugh at the time to come? Well, that's our inheritance. And then, of course, he sums it all up. He says, all are yours. All these things are yours. Everything is yours. And you are Christ's, which means Christ is also yours. And Christ is God's, which means you belong to God and he belongs to you. Now, if these things are real to you, beloved, I want you to square them up against the sin you're dealing with, or when that sin springs up, that temptation comes. I want you to square that sin up with the knowledge of all these things that are yours. And I want you to see if that sin can stand. And I'm here to tell you that it can't. It can't stand. I've experienced this again and again. This is what Paul says in Galatians 3. It's the very same truth. We started by the Spirit. How are we now perfected? By hearing with faith, hearing the gospel with faith. The Spirit is ministered to us. It's always this, beloved, the knowledge of what we have in Christ. Well, there is a contrast here, all right? We began the sermon by looking at a contrast. There is this contrast in the believer of soberness, of humility, and also of boldness and great joy that are one in the believer because of Christ. There's something really glorious about contrasts. There's a certain balance it brings to the equation. I was recently privileged to go to a Brazilian steakhouse, and if you haven't, you should. And they're bringing out the finest meats. And I don't remember what the cut was, but my favorite was this seared steak, all right? Which was, of course, extra rare on the inside. So the outside is basically like, burnt. It's crunchy, it's fully cooked, it's hard. The inside is in complete contrast with it. Juicy, rare, soft. And I'm gonna tell you, that contrast was glorious. You don't like it. You ever had, you like your salties and you like your sweets, but you know, if you get that chocolate with sea salt on it, it's a wrap. Contrast, beloved. Contrast. You know? There's something really glorious in contrasts. Well, there's a contrast in the life of the believer. Now, Paul goes on to talk about their humility, right? In chapter 4 here, in verse 7, who sees anything different in you? What do you have that you didn't receive? If then you received it, why do you boast as if you did not receive it? So he doesn't just lavish upon them the things they received, but he reminds them in that, you've received it. It's not yours. The gospel at the same time humbles you into the dust and lifts you to glory and joy in the same movement. There's a contrast there. Time will fail to speak of Paul in Ephesians 3, who says, to me, the least of all the saints, it was given to what? To preach the unsearchable riches of Christ. Contrast. That's how God works. And there's glory in the contrast, beloved. And the truly spiritual have it. Sermon wouldn't be complete without some Lord of the Rings. Let's take Gandalf as our example here. At one point, one of the hobbits looked at Gandalf, really squared him in the face, and really, really observed. He said, in the wizard's face, he saw at first only lines of care and sorrow. Though as he looked more intently, he perceived that under all there was a great joy, a fountain of mirth enough to set a kingdom laughing were it to gush forth. There's our contrast. Sober, militant, and yet in it, through it, under it, animated by childlike cheerfulness, bordering on giddiness. Amen? That's the spiritual person. I got a lot more notes. We're going to cut this one short. We'll end where Paul ends in verse 13 here. He says, we impart this wisdom, this knowledge, this understanding is imparted. You know, it's not just by osmosis, but it's in conjunction with God's word here, right? We impart this in words not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual truths to those who are spiritual. Now here he's talking about the wise, the mature, right? He says, we do give wisdom to the mature. So what's the contrast here? Well, it's milk and meat, right? He said, I wanted to give you milk, you needed meat. Hebrews talks about this too. I have to go back to the beginning. I wanted to give you meat, but I couldn't do it. Now, what some people think meat is moving on from the gospel into other, you know, deeper and more glorious doctrines. But that's not exactly right. To be strictly accurate, what is milk to meat? Milk to meat is the gospel and then its depths. What is it that he wanted to do in Hebrews that he couldn't do? He wanted to show them how Melchizedek foreshadowed Christ. That's meat. That's glory. Perhaps Paul wanted to pour out to the Corinthians what he pours out to the Ephesians when he soars the heights of God's grace in Christ, and he couldn't. The meat, the truly spiritual, is those who have tasted the gospel and have been brought to its depths. That's what he says. The Spirit searches the depths of God, the depths of the gospel, beloved. So I want to end with asking a question or two. How spiritual are you? How spiritual do you think you are? Another way to ask that very same question is to ask, how good of a grasp do you have on the things God has freely given you in Christ? How well do you understand and believe God's grace towards you? How well? That is spiritual maturity. To know and understand and to treasure, to know my position in Christ. Do I understand my position? It's a legal position. I have a right of adoption and sonship. Do you understand that? God is your Father legally. You are justified and forgiven and washed, and you will be glorified. To be truly spiritual, beloved, is to understand these things as they relate to you and to be animated with joy out of them. Now, a final word for anyone outside of Christ. Don't you want to get in on this? Don't you want this? Well, look what does it say? Freely given. Freely given, freely taken. If you are outside of the Lord Jesus Christ, all of these things and many more that we couldn't speak about will be yours now. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you would flex the power of your Spirit upon our hearts to give us a true knowledge of what we have in Christ, and with that to combat sin. And I trust you to own your word, Father, even through a weak vessel like myself. Pray in Jesus' name, amen.